certainly talents, is your creative ability and the ability to put your thoughts into words, coherent words, that people can read and understand. That's a real gift.
That's the plan, man.
That's the gift. And I hope you understand that. Is it okay for you to say that to yourself?
What, that I have a gift?
Yes.
I believe I'm probably better than a lot of people.
So there's a big difference, but Josh.
It almost feels like bragging to say I've got a gift.
There's a big difference. There's a big difference between arrogance and confidence.
I am confident I can write a novel, and I'm pretty darn proud of myself for that one.
Now, arrogance is saying I'm the best that there is, and if you criticize me, you're a fool. Okay. Confidence is your abilities. Are you confident that you're a storyteller?
Yes.
Okay. Are you confident that you can put together a coherent story that doesn't go off in tangential ways all over the place?
Yes.
Are you confident you can wrap something up at the end and have people actually understand the meaning and the story that you meant to convey?
I think so.
Okay. Okay. That's pretty impressive, don't you think?
Well, yeah.
Uh-huh. Did you ever sit?
I don't think it's anything to sneeze at anyway.
Did you ever sit and talk to yourself and say, you know what, I'm a good writer?
When I finished the book, every once in a while you tie up a loose end or something like that, or when you know it feels cohesive, mm-hmm. or even the next book that I'm writing, I'm in the middle of, and I'm like, oh, that's good. I'm like reading through it as I go back through and try to add some stuff because it's been a while.
So let's talk about that a little bit. Let's talk about your next project.
You got to get excited, you know, especially if it's your passion, if it's something you really want to do, you got to be excited for yourself. You got to be able to sit there and go, yeah, that's really good.
To find
get jazzed up about it.
To find your passion, to get that jazz inside you. That's what we help people do. We often talk about, do you want to be a human doing, just grind it out every day and like Groundhog Day every day? Or do you want to be a human being and being in your life? We challenge people to shake things up. We challenge people to go into rooms and identify, look at things that they've never seen before, go a different route, try a different way, and to avoid the complacency, the humdrumness of life. And that's your responsibility. We help people become their own therapist, their own wellness coach, their own nutritionalist, their own doctor, their own activity director. That's our challenge. And my challenge to you is to continue to explore your particular gift, your particular genre. And I want to know about this other book.
Right now?
Well, tell us about the formulation of it. I don't want to know about it because I can't wait to find out
what
happened in Pittsburgh.
Right. This book is 20 years after what happened. The next book is actually going to be a series that is all the events that lead up mm-hmm. to that apocalypse, and including that apocalypse.
So that's amazing. So, and again, you have a different view of the apocalypse. And in your book, God actually never, the creator, the divine, whatever you want to call it, never actually makes an appearance. However, it's referred to.
Correct. I actually have trouble differentiating or figuring out exactly how much of the mythos I've created is stuff that I actually believe and stuff that is just fantasy created for the book. Because the God in my book is actually what I actually believe, that it is. There's some sort of all-encompassing force that doesn't have a form or even necessarily actual laws for us. Isn't sitting on a throne with a beard and looking down on us and judging us for, you know, what we do behind closed doors or, you know, whatever. But that, you know, life is more about, nothing's black and white in life. Everything's all just shades of gray. And, you know, I don't know if I said it in this book or if I'm planning on saying it in the next one that, you know, like I said, nobody gets out of bed with the intention of being bad to somebody. You know, the guy that cuts you off in traffic, you know, maybe he bought like some poor old lady a latte earlier.
We don't know what is the story behind people's lives. We don't know what is driving behavior. And again, that's where we talk about stepping back and looking at situations. Did you ever stop and step back and look at your story rather than be in it as much as you were? You ever stop, step back, and look at it?
Oh yeah, you have to.
Mm-hmm.
You have to put it down for a little bit and then come back later, look at it with fresh eyes. And indeed, when recording the audiobook as well, you see it with another pair of fresh eyes, because you're reading it out loud, which you should do in your editing process anyway, which I did do a lot of. But, you know, even the more you read through it, the more you see stuff that you needed to change. And so I'm reading it out loud into a microphone, and I've got an engineer sitting over there. And so, like, I'm perceiving it, like, self-consciously through his ears, and realizing stuff that maybe I want to change. Or,
well, one of the things that we help people do is understand the power of their own voice. And sometimes what we challenge people to do is we ask them, the first time you heard your recorded voice played back to you. So the first time you ever heard your recorded voice played back to you, what did it sound like, Josh?
That sounded weird.
Well, that sounded weird, awkward. Is that me?
Yeah.
However, that is your voice. So quite often, it just is the same what you said, you alluded to, having people say their thoughts, say their feelings and what their needs are out loud, and they can actually hear them, is a great sense of empowerment. You're actually saying that to yourself. And how did it feel to read the book out loud, to hear the words that you had written and you created, hearing them yourself?
Yeah. Sometimes good, sometimes not so good. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody, like, you're going to be criticizing yourself into the ground, you know, forever if you keep reading it over and over again and scrutinizing.
Well, and what we help people also do, Josh, is learn the difference between evaluating and judging.
Mm.
Okay. If you're evaluating something, you're giving it a good objective view. If you're judging it, it's like, if I'm evaluating, I'd say, well, Josh has a striped tie on, he wore that today. Or maybe judging might say, my God, Josh, why would Joshua ever wear a tie like that? It just doesn't suit him.
The GQ, okay? Told me to.
What we're always asking people to do is to participate in their own creative process, to creating their lives, to add all the elements. What type of spices, what type of goods, what type of ingredients are we going to bake our life? What are we going to do? Just like in your creation of this book, you created it, and you took a number of factors out of your life, your imagination, real things, imaginary things, some things that you hope to be, and you put them all together into a big, nice mixture.
Yep. Yeah, I always tend to inject a lot of philosophy in my book, and you'll see a lot of it in the next one too.
And one of the things that was consistent to referring to God in this book was that even the antagonist Mar referred to it as the all-encompassing creator. Okay, so you're a creator,
the constructive force.
Beautiful. I love that. So you were the constructive force of this book, were you not?
Indeed.
And what we challenge people to do is to be the constructive force of their lives.
Indeed. And you'll there's a little bit more about that in the next book as well, where a character sort of explains that there's a constructive force and a destructive force. And so the constructive force would, they're both sort of part of a larger hierarchy, but, you know, it says that we humans are products of the constructive force. And as such, that is our goal. We carry out the constructive force's purpose in the physical, you know, to pray to the constructive force's folly when we are its outstretched fingertips, mm-hmm, in this realm.
I'm looking forward to reading your next book. And in the same vein, if we use those type of terms, the destructive force, the deconstruction force, could be the inner critic inside of people that constantly tear down your life, where what we try to do through self-validation is to have that constructive force.
Exactly. When you do damage, that is the destructive force acting upon you, or whatever.
And what we help people understand is they also can be part of that constructive force also.
Exactly. Since you are a product of the constructive force, you know, that's why you get that sense of accomplishment when you actually create something rather than destroy something.
And that's what we help people understand, that they do have that constructive force. But most people walk through their lives that unfortunately, Josh, thinking that it's just destructive. They got into a maelstrom, a hamster wheel of negative thinking.
Indeed.
Okay. So that's one thing that I did take away from your book. So tell us a possible timeline of this, your new venture.
The timeline for the next book?
Yes.
Well, let's see. What month is it now? It's March. Dang. I wanted to be done by now, but I've probably got another maybe 5,000 words left to write in this next one. Mm-hmm. And then the bulk of it will be done. That one was done about April last year, and then it took another 6 months to edit and released it around Halloween because it's a horror book. So that is probably what's going to happen with this next one. I would like to have it. I wanted to have this next one released by the spring, but now it's probably looking like it'll be around fall by the time it gets done.
So if we have folks out there who may be intrigued, have their interest piqued by this particular book, how would one obtain a copy of
Indeed.
It?
Indeed. Well, let's see. It's available on Amazon mainly through, you can get a paperback, obviously. You can get a Kindle version. It's on Kindle Unlimited. And Audible as well. And I think, it's been distributed through ACX, so it should be available on iTunes and out of the trunk of my car. I've got a lot. I got a bunch of copies.
So also what we're going to do...
Trying to get rid of them.
So also what we're going to do is provide a link to these sites on our program also. So
thank you.
If they go to our website, www.fishingwithoutbait.com, they can certainly do that. And I'm going to offer something out there. Perhaps for the first person who contacts our show through fishingwithoutbait.com, perhaps we could provide a autographed copy.
Yeah, sounds good.
Whoop, whoop. Get your copy. That would be great. So if you contact us, we'd be glad to send that out for you. And do you have a website, Josh? Do you have anything out there where people can...
Yeah, there's a Rogue Mountains Facebook page and an Instagram account at The Rogue Mountains. One of them has underscores in between. I think it's the Instagram account at The Rogue Mountains with underscores in between.
Well, we'll put that out.
But yeah, also, there's a Rogue Mountains website. I really should have just made a Joshua Tarquinio author page because now I got to buy more domains. So look out for that too. JoshuaTarquinio.com.
So what advice...
Nobody buy it.
What advice, what encouragement would you have for an aspiring author? Let's say a young lady or a young man who has some creative muse about them, but just can't seem to gel it together.
I've been thinking about this question for a long time recently, and I'm sitting in the car driving. I'm like, that is exactly how I would answer that question. What's your biggest advice? And... definitely know your talents, know your limitations, you know, don't shy away from criticism. You know, you might not have the knack for it. Go do something else. But if it's something you really want, you can get good at it. There are very few people who just can't do the thing they want to do. So if you really, really want it, you'll work hard to get it. And head down and grind, man.
So what we talk about is that nobody really fails. We find out things that don't work.
Exactly.
So and Einstein's definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. However,
learn from your mistakes.
We prefer to think of it as we found things that don't work. However, the real problem is if you keep revisiting those areas, because there are... You have inventory your gifts, talents, and abilities, and find somewhere where they fit.
Mm-hmm.
Find and your passion, and be that lion. Be that lion on the savannah that doesn't need push to run. They run from passion. I'm glad you found your passion. I'm certainly glad we found you.
Yeah.
So welcome. Welcome. Welcome, Josh. And as always, we offer a free prescription at the end of every program. Fruits, nuts, and vegetables. Unplug your television and perhaps take up fishing. And for a truly mindful experience, we recommend that you fish without bait. Do a kindness for yourself. Do a kindness for another. Forgive yourself. Forgive another. Till all are free, none are free. Thank you. Namaste.
Please check out our website at fishingwithoutbait.com, where you can listen to the show, comment on our discussions, and find out where you can subscribe to our podcast. If you're interested in flying the colors of Fishing Without Bait, click the shop icon on our website. We have clothing, mugs, cell phone cases, and so much more. Show the world that you fish without bait. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.